Hello, everybody. My name is David Packles. Super excited to be here at Amplify. Thank you to the Amplitude team for having me. Huge fans of the product, use it literally every single day. So I'm excited to share with you a little bit about what I've learned about building products. So today I'm here to talk about harnessing the power of emergent behaviors. Sounds fancy. I promise it's not. A lot of basic stuff, a lot of things you can learn here. But before we get into it, quick intro. My name is Dave Packles. I'm a director of product at Peloton. I've been at Peloton for 6 years now. I've seen it through an amazing journey of growth. Username Packles, representing Powers Up Peloton Dads. So hit me up on Peloton if you're already a member. So I'm here to talk about emergent behaviors. This is basically their usage patterns and hacks that appear organically within a very highly engaged subset of your community. There is so much insights to gain from this group, right? But you can't take it at face value. So there's something about translating that to a more mainstream audience. I'm gonna tell you how Peloton has done that with a couple different features. But before we get into it, let's talk a little bit about Peloton. So for years, home fitness was stale. This is the classic image of a treadmill that wasn't being used. But starting in the 2000s, especially in the 2010s, there was something happening within boutique fitness. So if you lived in near a major metropolitan area, you had $35 to spend on a class, you had childcare, you had the time, you could show up at a class, be surrounded by people who were all deeply in it, and be taught by an instructor, feel the music blaring in the dark, and it was just such an amazing community experience, and there was so much magic there. But it wasn't accessible to everyone. And so Peloton aimed to make that accessible, and we brought the energy of that that live boutique fitness class to the home. In 2018, we expanded it. We introduced the Peloton Tread, and only a few weeks ago, we expanded our product line even further. We now have 4 different products, depending on your price point, to have an amazing, amazing workout at home. So we also have a suite of digital products, TV, iOS, web, that if you're traveling or just want to dip your toe into Peloton, you can do it. And so we meet you wherever you are. But the heart of our product is our content and our instructors. We now film over 30 hours of content a day, ranging from cycling to yoga, outdoor running, strength training, taught by some of the best instructors of the world. They really become a part of your family. I cannot tell you how many times I've talked about my love for Alex Toussaint over dinner. He's the best. They really do enter your home, and you develop this real relationship with them. But where I come in is the software. So as I mentioned, the content is really the key, the relationship with each other and with the instructor. Our goal is to try to make the software fade away and to make it feel like you're actually in the workout or in that fitness class. Some of our core features, including showing metrics in real time, your heart rate, showing the songs that are playing, being able to like songs. But the cornerstone is this leaderboard experience, which is a somewhat competitive way to feel being like you are surrounded by people within a fitness class. You can essentially see people climbing the leaderboard. I'm going to talk a little bit about that later. We track your progress. We show how you're progressing. We reward you with badges for getting better, for working out with friends, or for hitting milestones like the Century Club. And music is a core part of this discovery experience as well. So you can see the songs that are played in the class. You could like them. You can save them to Spotify or Apple Music, where Peloton really becomes a means of music discovery, which is super exciting for me, who's personally a music fan. But as Peloton, we like to say that we own the entire product experience stack. And for this, it's more than owning app and backend, right? It's actually about owning the hardware, the software, and the content. So we manufacture our own products. We design the hardware itself. We obviously build our software from the ground up, even to the point of making our own custom software that lives on the tablets. And then, of course, the content. We have world-class studios in New York and London, where we're filming all this content and broadcasting it throughout the world. But it's not just our product stack that we like to own end-to-end. It's also our member journey. Technology product you may assume just has an e-com website. Peloton takes that a bit further. We have retail locations throughout the world, where you can go and try a bike or even connect with the community who's already there. From a logistics perspective, 60% of our bikes and treads are actually delivered by Peloton employees. So talk about like interaction with a brand. You're actually interacting with the human who's there teaching you how to use the product. And that's your first introduction to Peloton. That's really exciting to us. And of course, support. We pride ourselves on some of the best support in the industry. They are truly the heart of our organization. We learn so much from them, and and the satisfaction with that team is amazing. So what does that get you? It gets you one of the stickiest fitness products of all time. This is our retention. In 12 months, 93% of people are still paying for their subscriptions. 18 months is 86%. People love this product. It becomes a core part of their routine and a core part of their home, not just for one person, but for the entire family. But not only are people paying for it, they're using it too. So our workouts continue to go up year over year. And that's really, really exciting. And not only are people working out more, they're also diversifying their workouts. They're taking more strength workouts. They're taking more outdoor running. And that's really exciting to see, because for someone who started as a bike company, to become a true home fitness provider is really, really amazing. And that's really the mission we're striving for. But the heart of it, I know I said support and logistics are also the heart, but really where all of the inspiration comes from is our members. We're a members first organization. We learn everything from them. These are people who could do nothing but talk about Peloton to anybody who could listen. They celebrate their milestones together. They get tattoos. They develop relationships that last a lifetime. And we like to see that, like to be a part of that and help kind of build that trust and build that community. One way that people do connect is through Facebook. So one of our biggest communities on Facebook is 350,000 members, but there are also people on Reddit. There's people on different communities with people who meet at the retail store in Minnesota. But this is where these communities really start to form. But what's really interesting and where we take a lot of inspiration is the types of behavior that is being exhibited by these communities. Like, what are they naturally doing with Peloton that we don't offer from a product perspective? So it could be people scheduling classes to take together every week, or it could be creating custom challenges and rewards and merch around power zone training. These organic behaviors are so, so powerful, and there's so, so much we can learn from it. The question is, how do we make it applicable to more people? Because at the end of the day, these people who are on Facebook, while some of the most highly engaged, only represent a subset of our audience. And we can't just build for them. We need to build for everybody. And so this is where this emergent behaviors idea comes in. It's about identifying those natural organic behaviors from the most active members and finding a way to transition it to be applicable to everyone. It's not easy to do, but that's how you get real feature adoption at scale. And it's been incredibly, incredibly successful for us. The thing is that, emergent behaviors, they're usage patterns and hacks that appear organically within a highly engaged subset of your community. The thing is that this idea of emergent behaviors and transitioning them is not new. In fact, gaming is the best example. For years, the idea of a gamer was somebody who was in their basement, likely a teenager, and was addicted. But with the explosion of mobile phones, of mobile technology, the App Store, and things like Candy Crush, they learned so much from gaming and said, how can we introduce gaming to a completely different market who don't consider themselves quote unquote gamers? And that's just a great example of this idea of transitioning from a highly engaged subset, taking learnings and applying to more people. So at Peloton, how do we think about it? So we have two questions we ask ourselves always. How are our most engaged members using our product? And how might we productionize these behaviors to make them applicable to the widest possible audience? There are three core principles to doing that. And you may have heard these before. It's not rocket science here, but I hopefully could tell you how we actually use them and it can be valuable. One is observing users in their natural habitat. Find places where people are talking about your product, not to you, but to each other. Once you have ideas and insights from those users, validate them with a radically different persona. Don't just show the people who asked you to build something, show it to the exact opposite. If they're hypersocial, show it to the people who couldn't care less about being social. And then last, learn from failure and keep pushing. And this is like a key thing here, right? As product managers, we always want to be right. The fact is that we are not. And showing that vulnerability and being open to being wrong and learning from your failures and admitting when they can be improved is core to building amazing products. So I have two examples I'm going to share with you. The first is around our in-class experience, specifically our leaderboard. So when Peloton launched in 2013, one of the core innovations was this leaderboard. Essentially what it did is what we call time-synced competition. Essentially, when you joined a class, everybody who had taken the class previously would be there with you at the very beginning. So if there were 100 people who started before you, you would see 100 people on the leaderboard. So if you had a friend who started a week ago, you would see them on the leaderboard just as if they were starting now. So that was amazing when it was a small community. But as we scaled to 500 people on the leaderboard, 1,000, 10,000 people on the leaderboard, that feeling of connection was kind of lost, right? Especially because they were just lists. These are people who had taken these workouts potentially months, maybe even years ago. So we looked to our hyper-engaged community and found this one group called the 5:15 AM tribe. These are people who would wake up every morning and work out together at 5:15. They would plan out their workouts. They would identify someone who would lead the week, and essentially they would all take the workouts together. Clearly, that is not something that was applicable to everybody, but we knew something was there. So we said, let's test this. Let's see if this thing has legs. So we did test it, and we actually built a prototype of it, and it was called Friends Working Out Now. And essentially, the way that it worked was that if you had a friend who was working out, we would give you a little pop-up, and you would join them at whatever point in the workout they were. So if your friend had started 10 minutes ago, you'd jump in 10 minutes into the workout. We tested it with the 5:15 AM tribe. We tested it with people who were not in the 5:15 AM tribe, and people hated it. Time is one of the most valuable things and one of the reasons why people were buying Peloton in the first place. And people were not willing to give up 10 minutes of the workout just to work out with their friends. But what they cared about was that they weren't alone, that there was somebody on the other side of that screen who was there with me, who was feeling the pain with me, who was, you know, trying to push over that hill with me. And that idea of crossover was really, really inspiring. We said, okay, well, if 5:15 AM tribe is doing it, we're kind of at scale here. Are there other people doing it? And so we did this analysis and found that actually 96% of on-demand workouts had another member in them and they were none the wiser. This means that you weren't working out with everybody who had taken it previously. There was most likely a chance you were taking it with someone who was taking it right now. And that was really, really exciting to us because that really brings life to our product, that there is someone on the other side of that screen. And so we said, how can we build this at scale? How can we take this idea of riding together and build it at scale? And so we built Here Now. Here Now is one of our most powerful features and powerful innovations on the leaderboard in years or even since Peloton launched. And it sounds so obvious, but really that's the beauty of good product ideas. They sound obvious after the fact. Basically the way Here Now works is that anybody who is in the class right now will show up on the leaderboard. It doesn't matter if they started 30 minutes ago or started 10 minutes after you, they show up. And not only that, you can interact with them. You can high five them. And this is just an amazing way to feel that actual energy that we were trying to harness in the first place by trying to bring the energy of a live boutique fitness class into the home. And we're super, super excited about the Here Now leaderboard, but members are really excited about it too. In fact, 40% of our DAUs are using Here Now, and this is not something that they default into. This is something that they seek out. And to see this type of number is really exciting, especially after going through such an obvious failure. So again, really quick recap, observe, validate, learn. Observe using the natural habitat. We saw that people were naturally having these behaviors. They were planning with each other. We tried to build it. We tested it with a completely different audience. They hated it. We admitted it. And we essentially, we learned from that. And eventually we got Here Now, which is really a diamond out of this situation. So next, I want to talk to you a little bit about clubs. So cycling clubs, running clubs, huge part of fitness, right? This idea of being accountable to a group and working out together is so core. And we started seeing this behavior starting to emerge in our community, right? So again, we have a 350,000 person Facebook group. The thing is, that's really hard to connect with 350,000 other people. So our community started fragmenting into people who love a certain instructor, like the Cody Boo crew, or are obsessed with data, like the Peloton data junkies, or really love power zone training, which is a method of cycling training to help improvement over time. We saw these kind of organic communities start to emerge. And we said, how can we actually productize that? So we tried to. We basically said, let's build clubs. And so we did. We did some concepting, and we essentially built like a club dashboard, which allowed people to join a club. There was private clubs, all this stuff, and you'd be able to see people getting achievements, the classes that were most popular with them, et cetera. We tested it. The people in clubs were definitely into it. The people who were not in clubs were like, I'm not here to find friends. I'm just here to work out. And that was, you know, that kind of held us back a little bit because we said, okay, if we're building clubs, we're going to be kind of pigeonholing us to a certain percentage of our audience. We do not want to do that. We want a mainstream audience here. So we took a step back and said, okay, what's actually happening here? You know, we found that these clubs and actually other people were using this kind of location field, which was an afterthought early on in the process, to represent, you know, their favorite sports team or the club that they were in. We did an analysis and found that actually 3% of our members were actually using this as a way to represent their allegiance or an additional means of identifying themselves. And we were like, wait a second, hashtag, it's beautiful, it's simple, it's public, it's something that people understand. And so we said, could we build that for Peloton? Would that work for us? And so we did. We introduced tags last May. And since then, this has exploded in popularity. Not only is it useful for the clubs, it's useful for small groups of people who ride together. It's useful for people who are representing the college that they went to or Peloton dads represent. Right. So tags became a means of expressing yourself rather than just connecting with clubs. Some really amazing things that we've seen is people working for representing charities or causes that are really near and dear to their heart. And so tags became not just for the club people, but for everybody. So you can fill the leaderboard by the tags. You can, you know, see where, you know, which tags are working out now. When someone high fives you, you see what tag they're in. It's all very, very exciting and kind of brings a level of personality and community to the platform that we didn't have previously. So right now it's really exciting because we've seen about 200,000 unique tags created by our member base. That's just a lot. There's something for you, whether it's your sports team or something else, there's something for you on Peloton. So how do members like it? They love it. 50% of our DAUs have some type of tag. And that is, you know, to have half of your members use a feature that you created is amazing, especially when your benchmark is somewhere around 20% of the people who were social and were into clubs in the first place. This means we were successful in making that transition to mainstream. So again, coming back to that, we observed users in natural habitat. We respected the fact that group fragmentation was natural as we scaled. We built something for them. We validated with people who were less social. And of course, we learned from our failure and kept pushing. We threw out a decent amount of work when we, you know, designing for clubs and kind of pushed in the direction of tags. And it worked and it was worthwhile. We're very excited about it. So I do acknowledge that Peloton is definitely a unique case. We're a fitness product. Not everybody's a fitness product, though there are more fitness products every single month these days. Some ways that you can maybe apply this to your work. So observing users in the natural habitat, find where members are talking about your product to each other, not to you. Don't rely only on Zendesk tickets or research in order to get insights. Find where that organic chatter is happening and learn from it. Keep your finger to the pulse. Secondly, validate with radically different personas. Get concept to paper as soon as humanly possible and get it in front of people. You want to fail early. You do not want to go through cycles without learning. And last, learning from failure and keep pushing. Again, we want to be right. Acknowledge that you will mostly be wrong. Raise your hand, acknowledge that, and push your team to improve from there. You know, that's like a culture of failure. Obviously, this is something that is fairly cliche, but you know, from a personal level, you have to show vulnerability in order to make that work. So hopefully that was helpful to you. I was super excited to do this. Thank you to the Amplitude team and to all the folks who put on this amazing event. Be in touch. I'll talk to you soon.